I thought I could take a break today from taping. After last night's taping, the most intense video I've ever taped, the soft landing into the vision of oneness. Well, what happened was, apparently, someone didn't like that video. I guess I upset someone with that video. And I had a dream. And in that dream, I got a Dear John letter. I got a Dear John letter. A letter, like a long 5-page letter or something, typed out. And the letter was from God. And God, in that letter, God expressed the disappointment with me, great disappointment with me, and pointed out all my errors and mistakes and all of this stuff, and said, you know, it's just a shame, but we're parting ways, and this is it, this is goodbye. And wow, that was a heavy dream, let me tell you. That was unexpected. Apparently, the ego has had enough of me, and so I wrote me this Dear John letter, and of course it claimed it is signed to God, you know, it's from God, and in reading the letter, you know, it's the ego, but still, it was an intense, incredible experience to read a letter with God saying, we're through. You've gone too far. I'm so disappointed in you. You're such a failure. You've gone off track so badly, you know, that I'm not going to ever associate with you again. We're finished. That's, I mean, the day was like just, wow. I knew it was the ego because in reading the letter, the ego quibbles over semantics, quibbles over structure of concept, quibbles over all this stuff, which is just, you know, ridiculous to say that's God. But the ego believes it's God for sure, because we told it it's God. The ego's a projection, our projection. We think we created a new God, which makes us greater than God, right? Yeah, because this new God, his will is stronger than ours, and forces us to live in bodies and on this planet and die and all this stuff. So we figured that since our will and God's will is one, this new will is greater than God. We created a God that's greater than God. That's what we believe. That's why we worship the ego as God. Now, this mark here is ashes from a palm tree, Ash Wednesday, beginning of the Lenten season, leading up to the resurrection, Easter Sunday. And I'm in church and I'm listening to everything, as always. But now I'm hearing stuff, now I'm seeing the whole situation very clearly. That's a little unnerving too, actually. You just say, uh-oh. You look around and you say, oh, I hope nobody knows that I'm seeing through the whole thing now, uh-oh. Oh my gosh, I'm really seeing through the whole thing so clearly now that the ego had to dump me. Wrote me a Dear John letter and dumped me. Man, it's tough. It's tough. It's been a tough day. Have to stay in the mood of repentance. It's not every day you get dumped by God. So I'm still processing it. You know, that's a letter of a lifetime. It's a one time thing. Oh man, because what I said in the video last night, the soft landing into the vision of oneness, you know, that really flushed the ego out. The ego has had enough, has had enough. It was hoping that it could turn me around. It's finally given up. I can't turn you around, sorry, you've gone too far. Just seeing in church to church, just seeing what's going on now. I see what's going on. Wow, that's a heavy trip. That's a really heavy trip. There's no question about it. I've always said my whole life, all this worship in the world is worshiping the ego. For sure, it's worshiping the ego. There's no question about it. We're worshiping a God that we think we made. We think we made a new God. And we're worshiping it. We're appeasing it. And they say things like, God, I hope you accept this sacrifice. I hope this appeases your wrath. I hope this makes me appear okay in your sight. And you're not so angry at me. That calms your anger towards me. I hope you forgive my terrible sins towards you, because you know I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Don't take it out on me. I'm gonna change. And then the whole emphasis on personality changing your habits, changing your personality. I gotta be a better person. You know, this is what we do. And it's just like, uh-oh. Just seeing it all, just watching, observing, seeing it all. Personality level work is not the answer. The vision of oneness is the answer. And there is only one vision of oneness. And the vision of oneness is the knockout blow. Okay? We need a knockout blow. We don't need to fool around with our personality. Personality comes from perception. Okay? Personality leads to judgment. There's no such thing as a good personality. There's no such thing. Perception itself brings about a severe delusion, brings about a belief system, a judgmental system, a personality, severe insecurity. You cannot fix that at the level of working on your personality. That is the ego's advice. We need a knockout blow. A real knockout blow for this. The vision of oneness is that knockout blow. And the vision of oneness is the only vision of oneness there is. There is no other. There is no other. There's only one vision of oneness. That is it. That's it. And it's the knockout blow. So we are practicing to get to that knockout blow, because I'm telling you, it's very, very tough to see how deluded everyone is here. Just it's whew. Stay in the mood of repentance. There's no question the ego thinks it's God. The ego wrote me this letter. Just read me the riot act and pointed out how completely wrong I was about everything and how I just drastically disappointed in me and et cetera, et cetera. That's the ego. That is the ego. That is a projection of our own will and our desire to be greater than God. It's a projection of our will. It's not a separate will at all. It's delusion. It's whim. But until we can laugh that off and realize that what it is, which I did, I realized that's the ego, it's not God. Until we can do that, we're in bad shape, really bad shape. We don't realize the insidious nature of perception. Perception is the snake. It is absolutely insidious. And so we have to have a vision of healed perception. The vision of oneness is healed perception, all right? That's what it is. That's why it's the knockout blow for perception, personality, and judgment. And along with that goes everything else, you know? All the attempts to appease a wrathful deity. It's gone, all that nonsense. But what's scary is there's not a lot of us, you know, seeing this. I certainly see it. A little disconcerting, because you know the other people don't agree with you at all about this. The only way back to knowing the true God, the one true God without a second, is through solving the continuity problem that we have, is through the vision of oneness. That is what it's a knockout blow for perception, judgment, personality, projection. frees us from it. Frees us from it. And that's the only way we'll ever know the true God, instead of worshiping this God that we made in secret. We think that, you know, we can hide that fact from ourselves. We're worshiping this God. We made this God. It's a projection, and we're trying to hide this fact from ourselves so we can imagine that we're greater than God. And the even bigger problem is, as I've said before, that this God that we've made is trying to annihilate us, which is why we have these religions of bowing and trying to appease this God, because we say, hey, why is God so mad at us? We must be really terrible. And so then we say, well, we have all these flaws. God, I told a lie today. You know, I know you want to kill me for that, but I'm so sorry. I'll try not to tell another lie. The lie that we're telling is that this God is a God that we created, instead of a projection of our will, in an attempt to uncreate reality and to say that we're greater than God, because we created a new God that's more powerful than we are. Remember, we're the Son of God, has the same will, same essence of God. So the will that we have is one with the Father's will. And so if there's some will that's stronger than us, that means that will's stronger than God too. And we believe we made this new God, but we're not telling anybody. Shh, you know, no, don't say anything. Because if we say that, maybe this God will come after us. You see, that's the problem. We know this God is really angry, insecure. Why? Because it's not a God, it's a projection. But what we're trying to do is a funny thing. We don't want God to know that we made it. We don't want the ego to know that we made it. Because we know that this ego God is trying to kill its maker. And we're saying, it's not me. It's not me. God, it's not me. I'm just this body. I'm here in church. I'm praising you. That's not me. I didn't make you. Come on. No. I'm just a poor sinner. I'm trying to keep the commandments. I'm trying to be a good person. I didn't make you. Don't look at me. You know. And they say, Jesus is the one that made you. Go get him. And then we remind ourselves, yeah, God got Jesus, so he should be happy now, because that's the one that made you. Made that God. So we feel some relief when we focus on Jesus and crucifixion. It's because we think, oh, yeah. Say, hey, God, that's the one that made you, not me. But keep in mind that the sonship is one. There is no separation in the sonship. And the sonship is one with God. So we are the sonship. We are Jesus. We are the sonship. We are spirit. So we're playing this game with the ego God that we're these human bodies. So we don't get annihilated by this ego God that we think we've created, made, that's now trying to kill us. Now, why again is the ego God trying to kill us? Because it's only a projection, and it feels that its maker could withdraw, and actually wants to withdraw this projection, which would annihilate the ego, be no more. So it says it needs to kill its maker before its maker stops projecting it, you know. It's like actors on a movie screen. You're watching a movie screen, and the actors on the movie screen are saying, you know, we need to get up there and kill that projectionist, because I have a feeling that projectionist is going to turn them, you know, turn the projector off. So we gotta, it's like that. It's like the actors on a screen thinking they need to get up to the projection booth. That's, you know. The ego feels that its maker wants to end its existence. And so it wants to end its maker's existence before its maker ends its existence. And so it's in this desperate, terrified, it's really, the ego's terrified. It is a hideous experience, really. It's not happy at all. It's terrified. It feels that any second it could be annihilated. And the ego says, you want to worship me? You want to know how I feel? Okay, I'll show you how I feel. So you could help me out. I put you under the threat of constant annihilation, and that's how I feel, the ego says. Well, for instance, living on the West Coast here in the Cold War, we were under the threat of atomic annihilation constantly. It was absolutely terrible. We felt that the Soviets were going to launch, you know, missiles at us from either bombers or submarines without even telling us, and we were going to be obliterated off the face of the earth without even knowing it. Now, there's still early warning radar system towers in the mountains here, scanning the Pacific Ocean to try to give us some warning, but what good would that have been? So we lived under this fear growing up of total annihilation any moment. And the ego's saying, you see, that's how I feel. That's how I feel. Now you know how I feel. So now you know how to serve me better because you've got a taste of this. So, and thinking that the ego's God, we think that by suffering so terribly, we'll understand God's plight and want to help it. Of course, how do we help it? That the ego wants is to annihilate us before we stop projecting the ego. So what happens is, as you try to help God, the ego God, you end up going down into severe depression, horrible depression. And you think you're doing a really wonderful job for this ego God. So my main mission is to help those who are suffering from severe depression, suicidal depression, etc., explain, you know, what's happening, because it does happen. It happened to me. Absolutely. I'm just telling you what happened to me. And lived a horrible life because I thought I was trying to help God, but it was just the ego God. And again, almost everyone on the planet doesn't realize what's happening, because we're trying to keep it secret. We don't want the ego God to know we made it, because then it's going to try and annihilate us. So again, we're hiding in bodies. We're really spirit, but we're hiding in bodies and say, look, ego God, I'm just this body. I'm a stupid, you know, clumsy, aging body. Why are you angry with me? I didn't have anything to do with making you. I'm not the target. It's Jesus is the target. He's the one that made you. Blame him for it. Blame him. And so we say, well, Jesus saved us from all our sins, from meaning what? Saved us from the ego annihilating us, because the ego now thinks that it was Jesus that made the ego and not us. Again, we're one with Jesus. We are one with Jesus. And we say, no. Jesus, you are God, and we're just this poor little sinning bodies. That is a desperate attempt on our part to avoid annihilation by the ego God crucifying us and annihilating us. But guess what? We can stop projecting. Guess what? We can accept the vision of oneness. That's a knockout blow for the ego. And instead of annihilating me, the ego wrote me a Dear John letter. The ego God, a Dear John letter, says, I'm through with you. You've broken my heart. And I'm leaving you. It was really dramatic and full of all those flowery phrases, and you know, just so drama, emotionalism, and all this stuff. And that's what happens. The ego doesn't annihilate you. It claims it's leaving you. I said, well, good, leave. Go ahead, leave. But you know, it really can't leave you. It you just stop projecting it. You just stop projecting. Vision of oneness. There's no projection in that. Your perception, healed perception, is a different experience, because you're experiencing everything differently. The meaning of everything changes, and everything's is totally sacred. To what? To God. To everything. To everywhere. To God. Everything is totally sacred to God. And we start remembering what God really is, instead of this crazy ego God that it doesn't catch us, catch its maker. So these bodies are like the hiding place, you know. This world's the hiding place, we say. We say, ego, God, look at us. We're here in this terrible world, and this little body's like ants. You can crush us like a bug anytime you want. Don't mess around with us. We didn't make you. And of course, then when anyone starts talking about, hey, you know, I'm really spirit, you know, they say, shh, 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 shh. That's why you get shushed up. That's why they told Jesus to shut up. B-52s, huh? That's what we grew up scared of. Every time you hear an airplane. Jesus, shut up. Our God's going to annihilate us if you don't shut up. Because Jesus says, hey, you're all one with me. You're all spirit. You know, I call you to eternal life. You know, and they said, what are you talking about? We're just these little bodies. We're going to die and that's it. Come on, not eternal life. Quiet, quiet. I said, Jesus, shut up. You know, the ego God's going to find out that we're spirit too. Don't say anything. And they said, listen, Jesus, you gotta die because we're gonna prove to the ego God that we don't know you at all. I mean, you're not one of us. We're not one of with you. We're gonna kill you to show to the ego God that this is the one that made you, not us. We're good loyalists to the ego God. We're just dust. We're just dust in the wind. All we are is dust in the wind. I close my eyes. Yeah, close my eyes to the truth. Trying to close it and say, don't, I'm not a target. I'm not a target. You know, that's what's been going on in your life, in everyone's life, actually. Which is why I've always felt ostracized from the world, like the world hates me. You know, just shut up. Shut up. Don't spill the beans. Don't spill the beans. It's all, though, totally, you know, solvable with the vision of oneness. The continuity problem is the only problem I have, it's the only problem you have. We only have one problem, and the vision of oneness solves that problem. That's it. So, I have shown and seen and worked it through to show you there's an easy, soft landing. You can come out of a coma with a soft landing in the vision of oneness. I'm right at that point, getting, you know, very close to it. With that dear John letter from from God, the ego. So, you just see it as it is. Be honest about it. And if you realize the ego is just a projection, you can't kill me, ego. What are you talking about? I'm just projecting you. I can withdraw that projection any moment. And I would do so if not for the continuity problem. So, I'm going to accept the vision of oneness, and I'm going to say, of course, that this vision of oneness is the only vision of oneness there is. There isn't any other. This is it. This is it without a second, without another. This is it. This is it and only this is it. This is it and only this is it. This is the only vision of oneness there is. It's the only vision of oneness there is. There isn't any other. And this is the knockout blow. I want to reiterate that perception is so insidious. It causes us to really forget the nature of reality and take on all the personality traits. Personality grows out of perception. Judgment grows out of perception. When we're perceiving, we're judging. And when we're judging, we're personality. There is no way in the world that you can ever remember God, remember reality, as long as you are perceiving, getting your meaning through sensory perception, getting the meaning of things and spaciousness through sensory perception. There is absolutely no way. And so this has to be front and center of any teaching. Yeah? I haven't seen it there. It has to be front and center. Healed perception is absolutely essential. There's no way around it whatsoever. So we just have to get down to work. And the vision of oneness is our goal. And I found today, I woke up this morning, the Holy Spirit gave me an exercise and says, look, there's just one vision of oneness, not two, just one. I said, wow, very, very heavy stuff. Because when you the vision of oneness dawns upon you, you say, oh, this is great. I wonder if there's another one, some other type one. And then, you know, right then you disengage from it. Because we're so used to trying to make truth and lies compatible that we see truth and say, okay, that's truth. Okay, now what about the vision of oneness that love lies? What about that one? I wonder what that one's like. Okay, I got this one. Now what the other one? There is no other one. There is no other one. Just this one. And that's what we struggle with. So this practice of saying, there is no other one. There's just this, without a second, without another, just this, this and only this, just this and only this, just this. Vision of oneness. There is no other. There's only one vision of oneness. There is only one vision of oneness, and this is it. Working on that, I believe, is going to resolve the struggle we have to abide in it. Once it dawns upon us, then we need to just stay with it, because there isn't any other. There is no other. This is it. There isn't a second one. This is the only one. This is the only vision of oneness there is. There's only one vision of oneness. This is the only vision of oneness there is. There is no other. And yet we're thinking, huh? Should be another, shouldn't there? No. Well, we expect the ego God to give us its version. And supposedly it should be better. So we say, okay, I'm used to this one. Okay, I see this one. Okay, this gets me ready for the one, the better one that the ego God will give me. Now, the ego God can't give you the vision of oneness. There's only one vision of oneness. Just one, not two. Just one, not two. Just one, not two. One is one. One is one. One is one. It's not two, it's one. There's no two-ness, it's just oneness. This is it. This is it. So, very important practice. So there is a practice to enable us to abide in the vision of oneness. That's what I'm saying. No question about it. Because our fear is that we'll it'll dawn and then we'll back away and then the ego is going to just know that, oh, you're spirit, huh? I'm coming after you. And so no, we need to abide in it. We need to abide in it to feel really secure, really secure. And to do that, we realize this is the only one there is. There is no other. There is no other vision of oneness. And this knocks the ego out. It heals perception. It heals perception. And with healed perception, we don't feel afraid anymore. Because perception makes us feel terrified, really. Makes us feel estranged. Makes us feel separate. Apart. Lonely. Makes us feel very lonely. Very, very lonely. Perception makes us feel so lonesome. I've been lonely too long. Yep, as I look back, I can see me lost and searching. Now I found a way to choose. I'm free. Yeah, yeah. So funny, I could laugh. All my troubles been cut in half. I've been lonely too long. I've been lonely too long. We've been lonely too long. Because perception brings about this feeling of strangeness, that there's gradations, everything's gradations, judgment, everything's judge, you're judging everything. And you don't feel like you're at home. You feel like a stranger in a strange land. You really do. And of course, you turned into the ego god. Help me, ego god. Help me, ego god. Help me feel like this is home. What can I do, you know? And when the vision of oneness, there's no feeling of estrangement, like you're a stranger in a strange land. You feel like you're home. You're at home. Everything's at home. How could you feel at home if everything didn't feel at home, right? What kind of home is that? But when you see, you feel, the meaning is everything is totally at home and always has been. And then you realize you're at home too. Always have been. And the search, I can see me lost in searching no more. I found I could choose. I'm free. I found I could choose the vision of oneness. I found out I could choose that. And abide in it, because it's the only vision of oneness there is. There isn't two visions of oneness. There's only one. The ego will say, well, what about the other one? Why are you spending a lot of time on this one? What about the other one? Balance it out. Balance it out. How come you're not balancing it out? Come on, you need to integrate it. There's only one. So there's no balancing out, and there's no integrating. So by saying, no, there's only one, you take away the two of the ego's most essential tricks, is to say that we need to balance out truth and lies. And we need to integrate truth and lies. We need to make them compatible with one another. No. If there's only one, then how can you balance it with anything? How can you integrate it or make it compatible with anything? There's just one. There's just one vision of oneness, not two. Just one. So, these are very heavy times. What can you do? You got to face up to them. The world is running on emotionalism, and once you see the dynamics that are in play in this world, then you just say, uh oh. The world is not stable. Ego worshippers are not stable. Those who are projecting, perceiving, judging, personality, not stable. The personality is not stable. Forget about trying to fix the personality. It is inherently unstable. Inherently unstable. If you look at the great liberators, the great gurus, the great sages, avatars, saints, saviors, you realize that they don't have any personality. Just bliss. There's no personality there. And you kind of think, well, they don't really like me because I don't feel any personality give and take with them. There's no personality there. Personalities are inherently messed up. There's no way to fix them. No way to fix the personality. But you can be free of the personality. Vision of oneness is a knockout blow for that personality, that judgmental self, that messed up, terribly messed up. Personality is just nothing but messed up. Nothing but messed up. So don't even bother messing with it. It'll just forget it. I don't have a personality problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a personality problem, no. I only have a continuity problem. Vision of oneness solves this problem. There's only one vision of oneness, not two. There's only one. I don't have to balance it with anything. I just stay in it. No balancing needed. No integration needed. There's only one. Only one. So, this is the next step. Well, once it dawns upon you, then you start thinking, how can I get it back and abide in it? You know, and they have to see these further steps here of saying there's only one of them, not two. I need to abide in it because that's the next step in my life. I've gone as far as I can go with my previous life now, and I need a new life. I mean a new direction in life for sure. So it's absolutely essential that I abide in the vision of oneness. Only then is it possible to really help people with conviction and certitude beyond verbal expression. verbal expression is very clumsy. Subject to all the ego is interpretation. It's like a lawyer, you know, interpreting everything you say and twisting things. And it's an egoic lawyer. Not all lawyers are bad. I just say it's that way of you know, defending the ego, defending itself, twisting everything you say, and then throwing it back at you and saying, well, you meant this, right? Well, it sounded to me like you meant this, and this, and just battering you. So forget it. Say, I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a personality problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't even have a perceptual problem. I have a continuity problem. That is it. I cast all those problems aside, set them down. I don't have them anymore. I'm not caring. I'm not trying to fix them. I'm not trying to do anything with them. Why would I try to fix a problem I don't even have? I don't have it. I only have the continuity problem, and I have a vision of oneness now that I need. It's the only vision of oneness there is. I need to abide in it, and that's it. It's my medicine. I'm just taking my medicine. There is no other medicine. There is no other medicine. This is the only medicine there is. Vision of oneness is the only medicine there is. Vision of oneness. There's only one vision of oneness. There's only one. There's only one medicine for the continuity problem. I only have one problem, one medicine. 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 So, who knows what's going to happen tonight in sleeping? That's, whew. Man, I tell you, it takes a lot of, it takes a lot of nerve to get through something like that. And fortunately, you have enough, but you don't want to be dumped by God, even though you know it's the ego. You're still, it's just, because we've been believing this is God for so long. That's the problem. You know, we've all been believing that the God that we think we made through projection is the real God, is the new God, is the greater God, is the one that we need to worship. We've been doing that for so long, that to have this God, this ego that we think is God, to have that God dump you and tell you you aren't deserving of this God anymore. You know, that is very, very heavy trip. And for most people, that, you know, if they really believe that that is God, then of course they couldn't handle that at all. It would undo them. It would undo them. They would just freak out. Probably end up in a mental ward. Really. Or suicidal or something. Yeah. It's not going to happen to you until you actually are ready for it. Okay, that's for sure. But just the threat of it happening, the ego threatens it's going to dump you. It threatens. And so you think this God, you think you made this God, and you think it is God because you're hiding from the fact you made it. When it threatens to dump you, that really unnerves you. And it's always threatening to dump you. That's how it gets compliance out of you. Of course, it doesn't trust anyone. Because it says its maker is around here somewhere. It knows that its maker is around here somewhere. It's looking here and there, you know. And it's, and we're doing this act, this human body act thing for it, and the ego doesn't buy it entirely. You know, it's like, it just, the ego has this all-pervasive feeling of doom, you know, and threat to it. There's a hidden threat to it. It knows it's somewhere, there's this assassin that's hiding, and it's gonna get, you know, the ego thinks it's gonna get the ego. So the ego doesn't really trust anything or anyone at all in terms of this act that they're harmless to it, right? The ego thinks everybody is a potential enemy. This might be the one, the ego says. So it really views everyone as its, you know, mortal enemy, and it wants to get rid of you. Really, it does. So it's always threatening to dump you, just to test out, you know, can I trust this one? Can I trust this one? Can I trust this one? Oh, you're not doing enough prayer to me. You're not bowing to me. You're not worshiping me enough. I don't know. I don't think I trust you enough. I don't know. I'm not sure if I can trust you. When we say, oh, no, God, I pray to you every day. I trust you so much. I'm just this pathetic little groveling worm, you know, compared to you. You're so great. And the ego says, oh, yeah, but, you know, you don't quite, do you mean it? Do you really mean it? Oh, of course I do, God, of course. Well, I mean, did you, you know, sometimes it seems like you don't really mean it entirely. Oh, no. Well, sometimes I'm tired, God. Sometimes I'm irritable. I'm a sinner, you know. Have mercy on me, please have mercy on me. What are you waiting to do? I'll do pilgrimage. I'll do anything you want, God, just to show you I'm sincere in my mea culpas, and I really am sincere in my prayer. And the ego, God says, you know, I don't know about you. I'm not really sure about you. And we say, God, what can I do, God? Please, you know. God says, well, you know, you're just going to have to do better, a lot better. Okay, God, no problem. I'll do a lot better. And then the ego God says, and I'll be watching you. I know everything you do. I'll be watching you. Okay? I say, okay. And then we're like, you know, how do I, you know, go home, you know, drink some alcohol, smoke some pot, have some sex, listen to some music, and just try to, like, because you're freaking out. Freaking out. This God doesn't trust you. You can't get this God to completely trust you, so you feel this God is evaluating you, judging you, watching your every move, saying, you know, every move, is this the one? Can I trust this one? I don't know. I don't think so. Not entirely. That's the story of our lives. This God we have made doesn't trust us, doesn't trust anyone. Doesn't trust anyone. It's looking. It's always looking. It says, I'm looking at everything that's going on here. I'm noticing everything that's taking place here. There's a sinner here. There's something really bad. I'm going to find out, you know, where it is. I'm going to get it. Maybe it's you. See? The ego says it to everyone. Maybe it's you. Maybe you're the one. You're the one I need to annihilate, because you're the one who's the wicked one. The one that's projected, the one that is going to try to take away my life from me. And so this is the crazy meta story, underlying story, as it were, of our wretched lives here. Very wretched. Most people don't realize it because they're just in full appeasement mode. And someone like me, come in the world, I understood this to some extent. I battled it, I tried, and then I succumbed, but, you know, it never went away. So to me, it's a completely intense struggle and battle, and like, what's going on? Most people just say, whew, I'm just gonna, like, I just gotta pretend like I'm a complete idiot. I have no idea what's going on. No idea. Maybe God will leave me alone. That's the most we can do, and most people think, I just hope that God will leave me alone if I just am just nothing, you know, just nothing, and just lead this stupid animalistic life and die. You know, maybe I won't be annihilated. God won't go after me. And just trying to put it out of their minds, trying to think about it. But for me, all I could do is think about it. I said, wait, something's wrong here. Something's wrong. Something's crazy here. Really crazy. This world's completely cuckoo. And then, of course, you think God's after you. Because, you know, God says, I don't trust you at all. I think maybe you're the one. You're the bad one. And then you say, well, I said maybe you're the bad one. Because I'm saying that maybe you're the ego. Maybe you're the bad one, not me. You say I'm so terrible. I'm not that terrible. Maybe you're the one, you know. So then there's just like, you know, conflict. It's like, without help, we couldn't make it. We couldn't make it, actually. It's too scary. A lot of people with depression, anxiety, etc., they're scared. They're really scared. They're stressed out. They're really stressed out. Nobody I went to understood what was going on. Nobody. The only one who understood what was going on, the first one, was Jesus in A Course in Miracles. I knew he knew exactly what was going on. No question about it. And I said, I finally got a therapist. I'm going to get well for sure. But nobody else had a clue what's going on. You know, they if you tried to explain what's going on, they'd throw you in a psych ward and give you antipsychotic medication or something. Because I'm really saying, hey, God, no, you know, you're the bad one, not me. You're the one who's trying to annihilate me for no reason, because you're just a projection, you know. And the psychiatrist would say, you know, totally cuckoo. What's he talking about? Talking to God like that and saying God's not God and all this stuff. And they'd say you're completely nuts. But Jesus didn't say I was completely nuts. In fact, he said you're exactly right. And I said, thank you, Jesus, saved my life. Talks about projection, talks about making the ego, talks about we think the ego's God. The ego wants to annihilate its maker because we're drunk. Talks about all that stuff and clarifies it. And I said, finally somebody here giving the world the real truth. Finally. It's about time. Because this we're in anguish, we're in hiding. We keep hiding in these bodies, you know, like we're these little bodies. How can we remember what we really are when we're desperately hiding in these bodies to try to avoid annihilation from this ego god we think we created that's now a Frankenstein monster and wants to destroy us? How can we be happy? How can we feel at home when we think we're just, our home is limited to this little body? How can we remember reality? It's impossible. Not that way, it's impossible. We have to have the vision of oneness. And that puts our attention on the spaciousness. We say, wait a minute, there's this one spaciousness that embraces all. All form, everything is just embraced by this one spaciousness. Wow, that's really... that's bigger than the body, isn't it? Yeah. The bodies are still there, everything's still there, but you realize there's just this one spaciousness permeating, embracing and permeating them all. They're all abiding in it like a fish in the ocean. Everything. And then your attention gets off the body, is the body's not important anymore. Your little hiding place isn't so important. You say, what do I need to identify with the body for? You know, I'd rather identify with the spaciousness. With the sacredness. There's a sacredness that's everywhere. And that's what I really am. I feel this is reminding me of what I am. That's how it works. So once we see how severe our situation is, then we're willing to entertain the idea of vision of oneness. Most people think that it's like just something you get for an instant, just for an instant, and then that's it for your life. You know, that's enough. That's as much as you dare do. And then you can just say to the ego god, you just say, Just a fluke thing. It was just a fluke thing, some relic or something. I don't know what it was. I really don't know what it was. And then talk about it like you're dumb about it. And then the ego guy will say, see, they don't understand what's going on. Okay, they're just a dumb human, so maybe they're not such a threat to me. Yeah. We don't want to seem like a threat to this ego guy. See, that's what all this appeasement is about. All this appeasement is we don't want the ego god thinking we're a threat to it. So we're sacrificing our firstborn, the calves, everything, sacrifice, 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 sacrifice. Jesus comes in the world and we say, who's that? What's that? We hate that. It's there. Here, take it, sacrifice. Kill Jesus, you know. We don't want him here. The stuff he's saying is completely insane. We think completely differently. Yeah, he's a threat to you. We're not a threat to you. Not at all. Not at all. Look, go ahead. Kill him. I don't care. That's what the crowd said. Kill Jesus. Free Barabbas, you know, the murderer, you know. You know, we're simpatico with murder, you know, the people said. Not with Jesus. No way. Because they're terrified. They want to, again, reassure the ego god that they're no threat to it. No threat whatsoever. No threat here. I'm just an idiot. Don't know anything. I'm just sitting there watching television, giggling at the antics of these antic meisters. Watching the circus, guzzling some beer, watching the circus, eating some popcorn. Slobbering, giggling some more. Watching this violent stuff, this sleazy, violent, horrible dramas, legal dramas, courtroom dramas, all this horrible stuff. Yeah, this is soaking it up. I love this stuff. See, I'm no threat to you, ego god. This is what I love. I mean, spirit wouldn't love that, would they, right? Stuff, spirit wouldn't pay any attention to that stuff, right? See, I'm not spirit. I love all this mayhem and gore and decadence and wickedness. I love, see, that stuff. See, ego, I'm no threat to you whatsoever. No threat to you. I'm not spirit at all. Those over there, maybe they're the ones. Not me. St. Peter, I don't know Jesus. Not me. I've never seen him before in my life. I don't even know who you're talking about. I'm not a threat to the ego guy. I'm not a threat at all. Why, how could I be a threat? This is ridiculous. Yeah. And so we say, please, 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 Hollywood, make us more of the stuff so we can keep consuming it, you know? Keep on this, you know, keep me on this track so I don't appear to be a threat to the ego god. Please, please make us. And of course, Hollywood says, hey, this is what the people want. And we're just given what they want, which is true. It is true. Problem is the more you do that, the more you play dumb, the dumber you think you are, the worse the continuity problem gets. See, that's the problem. As we're all playing dumb, pretending we're not spirit by living lives of wickedness, we're building up this more and more intense continuity problem. So, at some point, we have to say, hey, I got a severe continuity problem, but that's the only problem I have. Really, I've seen that the ego is just a projection. It's not a problem. But the continuity problem is, because I've really forgotten what a true saint I really am, you know, that I'm not even the body at all. I'm this perfect, immaculate spirit that dwells with all of the totality of reality. I'm welcome by everything. Everything welcomes me. I'm such a great saint, everything welcomes me, and I welcome everything. That's a fact. That's what we all are. So we build up a very bad continuity problem. That's why I don't like people seeing people do what they're doing. it's very troublesome because they're going to have a tough time but this continuity, the way of being honestly saying I have a continuity problem, that is the way out of their situation actually. It'll have to be used at some point when they are willing to do it. Is simply just say, yeah, I do have a severe continuity problem, but that's the only problem I have. So if we spend all our lives acting like idiots, trying to convince the ego god that we're not spirit, and we do this life after life after life after all this so many times, you know, we've got a severe continuity problem. So what we do is we say yes. We just say yes, I do have it. I do have a continuity problem. But the Holy Spirit has the answer for me, a vision of oneness. I got a severe problem. But the other stuff is not my problem anymore. No. But I do have a continuity problem. So everybody in this world, they're working on their stupidity act. They're building up more and more continuity issue, you know, intensity to it. But it doesn't matter. Once we accept that we have a severe continuity problem, then we can start easily dissolving, going towards a vision of oneness. It goes faster than you think, no matter how bad it is. But still very gently, like a tortoise moving. You know, the tortoise gets there. Doesn't take forever, that's for sure. But again, people are afraid to associate with saints because they think, whoa, the ego is going to look at me and says, who are you associating with? You're associating with that saint. Hey, maybe you're a threat to me. Maybe you're the threat that I've been looking for. I said, no. I just thought they were a nice person and that's all. No, I'm not really interested in that. No. So you pull away. So saints have a very hard time of anyone associating with them, actually. Too hot to handle. Nobody. So, like Jesus said, you'll deny me. Once I'm gone, you're going to deny me. He said, you never even hung out with me. So we're not a threat to the ego. There is no ego. Ego is nothing. Just a projection. It's our own projection. It's like the projectionist is not a movie theater. It's not a threat to the figures on the screen. How can you say they're a threat to the figures on the screen? The figures on the screen are not alive. They're just a projection. So when the projectionist stops the movie, he didn't annihilate anything. He just stopped projecting these figures on a screen. That's all. So, once you see that, then you realize the whole thing crumbles, the whole facade, all this nonsense crumbles. But when you ask yourself, how come Jesus doesn't come back? Ask yourself this: who among us would be willing to associate with Jesus, and when and if Jesus does come back? I believe he will come back, actually. But who among us is willing to associate with Jesus? That's the question. Anybody? Is there anyone in this world who's willing to associate? Right? I certainly will. But we'll have to see. That's how I feel. Because the ego, you know, I'd say, hey, ego, you already dumped me, so what more can I? You already know that you can't trust me to believe in you. But of course, other people may. I don't know how it would go. But, yeah, why not? Of course I would. But, you know, how many in the world would be willing to do that? Because, again, your cover's blown. Once your cover's blown, it is blown. Totally blown. You know, we say, I don't want to blow my cover. You know? I mean, people go to the saints and they interview them or question them. They want to be with the saint. So they ask questions. I'm a journalist. They got all these covers for it, you know. But you don't need to ask the saints any questions like that. If you don't ask any questions, people might think you're simpatico. So just hang out with them. Don't say anything. Just hang out. So the more we see these dynamics, the easier it gets. But it's necessary to see it. You have to understand what this crazy place is really go what's really going on here. We don't really have to hide from the ego, but it's our desire to be prime creator, which is generating all this. But remember, what's really holding it in place is your continuity problem. When you realize you only have a continuity problem, then you're no longer really scared of the ego. You don't have an ego problem. You have a continuity problem. You've accepted your responsibility to deal with the continuity problem. Once you do that, that's it. You're free. You no longer are bedeviled by all these dynamics of the personality and the ego and stuff. You're not. And doing this practice, look what happened. I mean, God just wrote me a Dear John letter, and I just shrugged it off and said, there's just the ego. Goodbye. Good riddance. Good riddance, I said. Good riddance. All because of accepting that my only problem is a continuity problem. That's it. And I know the vision of oneness is there, so what worries do I have about that? No, nothing. No worries. So that works. It works, it works, it works. And we definitely need something that works right now, okay? Without question. We need something that works. It works. So use it. Use it, use it, use it. And then you can sit with Jesus easily. Just say, why not? All I got is a continuity problem. Jesus knows that. So I don't need to fool Jesus or anything. No, I said, Jesus, I got a severe continuity problem, and that's the only problem I have. And I'm open to whatever practice I need to do to get ready for the vision of oneness. And that's fine with me. That's it. That's not, nothing more need to be said. And Jesus would say, yeah, great, great. That's it. Nothing else need be said. And then you just keep on track for the vision of oneness and abiding in it, realizing there's only one vision of oneness, not two, just one. There's always just one. It's all there is. This is it. This is the vision of oneness. This is it. There isn't any other. And you, so, yeah, piece of cake. So, I very much advise everyone to start turning your attention to saying, I got a continuity problem, a very severe one. It's the only problem I have. And everything else that comes up, say, no, I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a threat problem. I have a continuity problem. Use that. It is the most powerful technique that I have ever come across. And literally, when you accept this, you can feel right away that you could sit in the presence of a genuine saint, a total liberated being. You could sit in their presence and you wouldn't feel nervous at all. No, because you're being completely honest and say, I do have a severe problem. Absolutely. Continuity problem. And just easy, easy. Give it a try. Because we're gonna need to sit in the presence of saints at some point. Because this world, again, is completely wacko. All these spirits pretending they're bodies, trying to appease this God, trying to blame others. Say, no, not me, it's them. They're the bad ones. Go get them. Personalities are inherently completely messed up. The whole planet is based on specialness and personality and judgment now. It's the cult of the personalities in charge. We're gonna need to sit with saints at some point, for sure. For sure. So, I'll go first, I'll go first, I'll go, no problem. If there's a saint somewhere, I'll go. get it started. We gotta sit with them, because that will free us from this madness. The world is in the grips of madness, really. Just off the chart madness at this time. And again, we're so desperate to pretend we're stupid that we pretend we don't even know what's going on. But the smarter ones are starting to wake up. They know. They can tell. They say, hey, it's a very bad situation in the world. Cult of the personality is in charge. Very bad situation. And the right to be like, whoa, you know, this isn't good. I need to wake up. I need to, you know, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? I have a severe continuity problem. Just make the confession. Just that. Just say, you know, Holy Spirit, I got to, or just say, I have a severe continuity problem. You can say, Holy Spirit, you know, or you just confess it. I have a severe continuity problem. I'm afraid to come out of my coma, but it's the only problem I have. That's it. Don't have any other ones. Just this one. Totally centered then, right? You can sit in the presence of a liberated saint, a savior. You're so centered, you can do it. Totally centered right there, right? You're centered. You've accepted your problem. Bring some peace, bring centeredness, brings focus. You feel very responsible then. You don't feel all jittery. You won't feel jittery. You'll feel calm. You say, I belong here. You say, I belong here. I'm a member of responsible society. Okay, that's what we need. So, all right. Let's see what happens going to sleep tonight. Hopefully something great. Hopefully something great. I'll just center. I only have a continuity problem. Before going to sleep, I'm just going to carry that right into sleep and get through it, whatever happens, for sure. All right. Appreciate everyone who's for watching. Appreciate everyone that's watched this video. And hopefully some of this is, you've been able to take it to heart. Very intense stuff, for sure. And we'll see what happens. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.